I was born in Mieszków, Poland, and I went to school there till the third grade. Then my parents sent me to all-girl school in a big city, and I stayed with my grandparents. And then when the after the high public school, I went 1 year to a, it's called in Poland, it's called a high school, but here it's called like a business school. Then the war broke out, and I went back home, and we were very close to the German border, about 7 kilometers. So my parents ran away with us all and a neighbor. We bought a wagon and horses, and we ran away from there till we come to the border, to Russia border. And my parents don't, my mother really don't want to go into Russia. So we come back to home. We was home about, would say, a half a year. Then after the half a year, they said, Judenrein, we have to go to a ghetto. And the ghetto was in Warsaw, I mean, in Zawiercie, called Wartenau in Pol, in German. And they took us, all of us, my brothers and my one brother, because the other brother, but has never come back, he went for my father. He took out my father's name and put his name in, and he was 13 years old or 14, and he took him to a working camp. And when we was in the ghetto, my parents were hidden in an attic with some friends, and they took us out on a big marketplace. And they said that young people should go this way, and because we used to have carts, but we worked in a factory there for the Germans by the uniforms. And my parents were hidden. When 10 minutes before the whole thing was over, I saw my parents coming. The Germans found them in the attic, some Polish guy, for half a pound of sugar, told them where they are. They brought all of them out and put them on the pavement and with the face down. And I wanted to run there when I got a big smack through my bottom from a German policeman, and he never allowed me to go there. Then they took all of them, my brother too, that one what is in Israel now, Zvivain Feldbaum. They took them to a big shul, and they hold them there about a half a day. And us, what we have the papers that we worked, they let us live in there. And they took my parents, we don't know where they took my parents. My brother, they went to a camp. And he don't know what they took my parents. And then I was by myself with the other girl, and we lived in a small apartment. It was like a store before, about, I would say, maybe a half a year. And there they started to take, they took us all away from there. I was not bad in, there was not so bad in the ghetto for me, because I used to have a friend, a non-Jewish guy, what his parents was born in Gdansk. Gdansk belonged before to Germans, before 1914. Then he was in, they took him to the military, to the German military. He was in the uniform, and he used to come to the ghetto gates and bring me bread and butter, food. And so then after everything that we worked there, we have to go Judenrein, they said, and we all have to be on the market, and they took us out to the trains and put us on the trains, and they took us to, we have not known where we're going. When we stopped the train, we saw a big sign, Auschwitz. They took us off on the Auschwitz. We have nothing and only the clothes. And they sat at the old people this way, and old young people there, and children with the old people. And they said to us, they take the children, and the old people will watch the children. And we never saw the children and the old people no more. And I was in Birkenau. And every morning, they have to go out for Zählappell. They count us. And before this everything happened, they put a number on your arm. And you was not a name there, only the number. And when you and shaved us like the whole hair, every place, and put some striped uniform on you and wooden shoes. That was all right because we know that we will live, because the people, what they don't know, they don't put numbers on and not shaved, they know they were never alive no more. And then they put, I was in a black number 8, I think. I don't remember for sure. And did not work from the start because we were very sick. Some people were sick. And every morning, we have to go out and stay there. And some people was older people, so they took them out. And we never know where they took them. Later on, I was going to work to I don't know how do you say fields, but we only knocked on big stones, make small gravel. This was our job, and then they'll give us to eat nothing only till the evening. When we come, they give us a little slab, water with something in it, and a piece of bread. And we slept in a like a wooden things, 1, 2, and 3 on 1 and 3 on the top. And no covers, no nothing. And then I was there about 3-4 months, work by the stones. Then I used to have friends, when we used to go to work, men from a different camp, we hear the name, they called the names, you know. Like they called me, Mania, Mania, you know. I don't recognize who they are. When there were some cousins far, you know, 3 times removed or something, and they were on the men's blocks, but we can never see them, you know, from there. And we have got the wires were electric around Auschwitz. And so they sent some cigarettes or something to a Blockältesten, what was over us. For me, and she took me out from the stone cutting to a potato bunker. And we worked in the potato bunker, like by for the German, you know, for the food. And then we have got potatoes to eat raw, and the carrots, and cabbage, and stuff like this. And it was terrible because there was winter, and I got very sick. I got typhus, and they took us in the hospital. It's called in German Revier, and I met there many girls from my city and from the city that I used to go to school with. And I met there a girl that was named Kitty Felix. Her father was non-Jewish, and her mother was Jewish, so she and her mother was there, and they were nurses, and that hospital. And one time she gave me, I could not eat and I could not, nothing to do because the typhus makes you very weak. And she used to take me from one side to the other side because the flesh should not get, sores. Then one day she come in and she give me some bread with little, garlic put on so I can eat, because she say, if I don't eat and I don't start walking down, they will take me to the guest chambers. And then she tried to take me down to walk, you know, and there was big, long, stove. Oven, you know, that was going over the whole block. And she tried to put me up there and go down and up there and go down. So then She come back after 2 days and she say, I'm sorry, Manya, you have to go out now to the camps to work, and me too, because all of the people, your friends and everybody is no more here. They all went to the, you know, to the gas chambers. Then I went and worked in the same thing like in the potato bunker later. And then after about a few months, I don't remember when there was, they took us out from Auschwitz and they put us to Brzezinki. It's a suburban from Auschwitz. And we used to work in the barracks, put together clothes for the our people brought, and looked for gold and put in boxes, you know, and shoes, put on the shoes. And that was the worst camp because there was old crematoriums were there. We were so far about, I would say, 200 meters from the crematorium. When we could hear the noise and we could hear the scream, when we could not see because there was the wires, the electric wires, then was the plain wires. And the wires was covered with, how do you say it, blankets. Every Friday, they took us out and put us one, and we was wearing no clothes. And there was a German, I don't know who he was, and he used to say, Rein raus. And when he was Rein, you were okay. When you were raus, you were dead. So the whole thing was, we were scared every Friday, you were scared that you will be the last. We used to make our cheeks very red, you know, to make us a little bit more alive, you know. And one time, along before, I wanted to go myself to the to a gas chamber because my feet was very sore from the walking to work, and I have got big stuff here like sores. So I wanted to go by myself there, and the girl that was like a nurse in the block, she come out and smack me in the face, and she say, what are you, crazy? You are so young, where are you going? I say, I cannot walk no more. So she say, I let you stay one day here, hidden, so you don't have to go to work. We were there in Brzezinki about, I don't know how long, but I know there was, I was there about till 1944. Then the Russian was coming. You know, the Russian were coming close. So they took us out. We walked about 3-4 days we walked. When we walked, we come into Germany. There was about, I would say, 2,000-3,000 girls going. And there was only maybe 100 soldiers with us, the German. When, where do you run? You are in deep Germany. You were scared that you be caught. And so we never escaped. And they took us on trains later after many days, and we come to a big camp called Ravensbrück. In Ravensbrück was so many people there in Ravensbrück that it was unbelievable. We have to sleep outside on the pavement because there was no place no more where to put the people to sleep. And the filth and the waste and the whole thing. Then one day, maybe a week or two I was there, they come out and they took 60 girls and I was between them, and they took us to a camp, it's called Malhof. There was no more, it was a working camp. There was no more electric wires around or nothing like this. And we used to see soldiers what was captured from the German, like Italian, American, and many other Russians, and they used to always tell us, tomorrow is the war over. That was 1944. The war is over, the war is over. We was very happy, man. We still have to go to work. We used to work in a factory underground, ammunition. factory, little bullets. And I was working by a press, you know, to make the bullets. So we were not so scared no more there, because there was no more like SS, because there was the Wehrmacht. The Wehrmacht is all the people, you know. They used to leave us some bread under the benches and stuff. We used to take little piece of bread, and I used to put in their machine, you know, where they make the little bullets, and the machine blowed up inside in their thing. They could not hurt me because there was like in a little room. And we stood there 3-4 hours, we did not work. And there was the sabotage what we used to do because of this. And then we could not do nothing, so we used to make, sometimes at night, we used to put a piece of, like a girl used to have a cigarette maybe, a light, so the planes were going on top, so the lights, you know, because the whole factory was underground. And upstairs they looked like a park. And we used to, going back from work, they used to go with us women. They were like SS or something. I mean, they were not so bad no more, because they end the war, they were scared too. And they used to go big trucks with fruit and or vegetables, and they used to stop the trucks, and they asked them, what time is it? And they make the us with the, like this, to go and jump on the wagon and take some food, you know, for other girls what is not work there. And then when we, that camp was, every day in the morning we used to go to work and come back, and the food, like always, no food, only a little soup and a little piece of bread. And there was no more a concentration camp, there was like a working camp. And then one day, 1945, before the war is over, the war was not over yet, and come a big trucks, Red Cross trucks. And they said, we are going to Sweden. They took out 1, 2, 3 blocks, and I was between the 3 blocks, one in the second block. And they said that we are going to Sweden, to a country that never was in war, and it's neutral. And we were still scared, because people was talking, it's saying, are the German doing, and then they take us to the guest chambers, you know. And there were some girls that understood English. And the drivers from the Red Cross drive was English. Not English American, but English English. And they told them that, you know, we are going really to Sweden. And they took us on the buses, the Red Cross buses. They give us to eat very little, because they were scared that we have not eaten so many years. At some girls got very sick, you know, from. And they took us, we went with the buses about, I would say, one day. Then the German was bombing the buses too, and we used to jump off the buses once in a while. And the last bus was bombed, and many girls were killed. Then we come to a place where there was like a, where they open, where you go to one country to the other.
A border.
Yeah, to a border. And they open the border, and we go in, and we see Germans again. So we say, oh my God, we are back in. No, they say, this is Denmark. The Germans have nothing to do here with you. They only are occupying that place. And they took us to a big nunnery, and they give us, there was big tables with white cloths on it, with bread, and with, you know, bread and cakes and milk. They don't give us food like meat, because they were scared that we got sick. And they said, some girls used to take the bread and the sandwiches and put it in the packets. So the nuns used to say, don't do it. You will have plenty to eat where you're going. So, and then about a day later or two, they took us on big trains on a boat, like a ferry. Denmark from Sweden is only an hour or two. And they brought us to Sweden, to Malmö. The music was playing on the station. And they gave us cake and some milk and water if you want it. And they took us to big, big places for the cat. They loused us, like, you know, took us, they put some stuff on us, you know, smelled terrible. All the clothes they put away and they burned it and they give us clothes donated by people in Sweden. And they took us to school, a big schools, and there was like a hospital, and we were on a quarantine. We were not allowed to go out. There was military around us because many girls have got typhus, they come with lung sicknesses, and very sick. And we were there about, I would say, 2-3 months. And I was not sick, really, so I used to go with a Red Cross lady out. She took me out in the bus, you know. I was not allowed to go out from her car. And this was the stuff, but the Swedish people was very nice to us and very cordial, you know. They give us food. They used to throw food and throw clothes through their gates, and the police used to not allow it, you know, because they had not known what the sickness we have. And this was Sweden. I was liberated from Swedish Red Cross about 2 weeks before the war was over. And when the war was over, when Germany capitulated, there was music in the street, people were dancing, you know, and stuff like this. And then I was in Sweden.
How long did you stay in Sweden?
In Sweden, I was 9 years. And I worked in a factory for dolls, stuffed dolls. And then I got married in 1948. And in 1950, I born a little girl. Then after a little while, people started to be scared. They said, Sweden is in Europe and there will be again a war. So I got, my husband has here got a brother-in-law that is deceased, a brother too. And we applied to go to United States. And we got the visa, and after 9 years, we come to the United States. And we are happy here, we work, and this is all.